Some of the game's most famous modifications have up to tens of millions of downloads. Maybe you've played with some of them individually. Or you play with several mods at the same time for a more interesting game. Some madmen have attempted to play with thousands of mods at the same time. These experiences usually only last several hours before becoming completely unplayable. Playing the game with hundreds of random mods thrown together without any coordination is usually not fun. Due to reasons such as, but not limited to, frequent crashes, many conflicts between items from different mods, poor performance, and other BS. This is why most modded playthroughs only include 10 to 20 mods. Thanks for watching. However, scientists from NASA have been busy. What if there was a way to make a fun experience, keyword fun, that is optimized and quite fun, using over 100 mods at the same time? And somehow make a way to connect every mod with each other for a more immersive experience. It was not going to be easy. It was the opposite of easy. Which is hard. But finally, it was done. Now introducing mod packs. Conglomerations of hundreds of different modifications made by other people that have been put together and heavily edited so that they would all work with each other and would be enjoyable to play. Mod packs with hundreds of mods just thrown together in no logical order are called kitchen sinks. Quote unquote kitchen sink mods let you experience the features of each of the most popular mods at the same time. One kitchen sink is called Infinity Evolve. And this was my first ultra modded experience. When you begin a world with these mod packs, you are usually given a guidebook explaining how to start off, what you should do to progress, and what the end goal of the game is. Most mod packs also feature just enough items, which allows you to search up the recipes of any item you want to craft, and see the different possible ways of crafting it. In Infinity Evolved, the goal is to craft this incomprehensible hunk of items, which has hundreds of steps that require you to use most of the mods offered in the pack. However, this video is not about Infinity Evolved, it's about something else. But before we get there, I will first talk about this experience. It all began when the hoster of a server called DaBabySMP invited me to play on his Infinity Evolved server along with several other friends. As with most other people who begin playing these games, I was overwhelmed by the sheer amount of new features, items, and stuff. My senses were overloaded after being so used to the simplistic nature of Hypixel for years. To make sense out of what these are, the four main sources of mod information were the wiki made by the same creators of the mod pack, the Not Enough Items GUI, Reddit help pages, and a guy known as Ancient Old Man. He showed me how this. What is this? How is this? What are these? And I eventually got the hang of ultra modded Minecraft. After several days of progressing and attempting to craft the end game items, Ancient Old Man whispered in my ear. As it turned out, Infinity Evolved was not the only thing he had experience with. He had been a connoisseur of mods. And he rated Infinity Evolved a not good out of good. And he suggested another mod pack to play, called Enigmatica 2 Expert Mode, created on November of 2017, in collaboration between this guy. It was published on Curse Forge, to be met with only a little over a million downloads. Similarly to other packs, it combines several of the most well-known mods and has hundreds of other lesser-known modifications. But there's a difference. The progression. In Infinity Evolved, progression looks a bit like this. You can start anywhere and basically play with whatever you want in a normal playthrough, with no logical order. Usually you can reach God mode in a week due to how accessible everything is. It's easy and fun. But in Enigmatica 2 Expert, things are a bit more logical. It's harder and challenging-er. Progression in Enigmatica comes in tiers. You must begin with basic items from the first tiers, of which there are a few. You must then use the items from the beginning tiers to make tier 2 stuff, and so on, up to tier 4. There is no skipping any mod. Everything is there for a reason. With the items from every end game mod, you must create the ultimate crafting table. This leads you to the end goal of the game. The Bragging Rights quest line. With the 9x9 crafting table, You must craft each one of these overpowered items, which uses materials from every mod in the game. These usually require hundreds of steps, and tons of expensive materials. These steps include creating artificial dimensions filled with materials required for the end-game armor, which requires millions of diamond emerald coal quartz, creating a sacrifice altar to genocide thousands of villagers, creating a warp drive spaceship to travel to another planet for a shiny rock, 1v1ing this absolute boss of a dragon, and more. But of course, if done the wrong way, you will never finish this mod pack in your human lifetime. I mean, I could, but this brings us to our next point. Automation. In most Minecraft servers and stuff, grinding has to be done manually. If you want wood, you must punch it yourself. If you wish to beat the wither, do it yourself. But doing things manually in this mod is looked down upon. A big part of progression is coming up with ways you can automate resource production, crafting stuff from resources, slaying stuff for resources, and basically anything important. Because later on, you will find yourself needing millions of things that are just too tedious to get manually. But do not fear. Due to all the mods in this game, all the tutorials in YouTube, and other tutorials, you can eventually do everything automatically, typically with pipes transferring stuff, conveyor belts, machines that craft stuff for you. But not just that. Nearly anything is farmable eventually. Nether star farms, metal ingot farms, everything farm. If that's too slow, there is an automatic quarry, and 100 more ways to obtain hundreds of other materials. Without automation, well, good luck, buddy. While this pack does require a lot of manual grinding, this is where it becomes different from Skyblock. In Skyblock, you usually find yourself doing the same activity for tens of hours on end. But in Enigmatica, you will have to constantly switch between different activities due to the complexity of crafting recipes. I never really found myself doing the same thing for more than an hour at most. Speaking of crafting recipes, they have been heavily modified to make reaching end game harder. Certain vanilla recipes have been changed to make them more challenging. Even basic things such as chests and wooden planks have been brutally slaughtered. Each log gives 2 planks. To get the usual 4 planks, you need this machine, which requires all of these other steps. But that's not the only way to make planks. Simple things like wood planks can have up to hundreds of ways of obtaining them, most of them with varying efficiency. And efficiency is important. Many items and resources you will need have different ways to obtain them. A big part of the game is to find the most efficient and convenient way of getting materials. Is traveling to Neptune just to get star metal too annoying? Use this other easier method then. Is platinum ore too rare? Use this way more convenient method. Quite a lot of shortcuts can be found just by looking through all the different methods of getting something, and stumbling upon a method that is way cheaper or convenient than the rest. Or, you can find really useful items by being lucky and finding loot randomly generated around the world. World generation is heavily changed in this mod. Not only does it feature biomes aplenty, which adds hundreds of new biomes, but it also adds many new structures. Villages have been renovated. Their loot table has been expanded dramatically. There are also new structures to explore. Giant forest towers. Ancient gears in the desert. Underground dragon dens containing convenient items. And there's probably more. Exploration in this game is quite rewarding, and can lead you to some pretty unexpected findings. And finally, before we get into the actual playthrough. Resources. As the game progresses, things will become more and more resource heavy. Eventually, you will find yourself needing millions of ingots and thousands of mob drops. So plain old mining and gathering is not going to do the trick. Most of you guys probably know Hypixel Skyblock. And you probably know minions. Well, there's minions who will sift through gravel and find pieces of ores which you can combine together. Later on you will have access to the Void Miner, which can give you access to even more ores than the other machines could. In the end, you will have to use the Dimension Builder, which is basically a mini world generator, inside your world. With the right materials, you can create dimensions made out of any material you seek. Do you want a world of huge balls of diamond blocks? No. You do not want it. You will need it. A dimension filled with glowstone blocks instead of diamond blocks. A dimension where ender dragons spawn without end in sight. It could provide you with an infinite amount of any resource possible. Anything was possible with it. At a hefty cost. You see, while the material costs of the dimension builder are something to be considered, there are more than just items you have to take care of in this mod. Liquids, gases as in oxygen and stuff, and energy will also be important resources that will be needed throughout most of the game. Liquids and gases can be transported using storage tanks, and will be used frequently in recipes. Many machines in the game not only take material inputs, but fluent inputs as well to craft items. You will also be converting your experience levels into liquid experience and using that to craft these thingies. Eventually, you will be finding yourself needing thousands of buckets of certain liquids to mass produce things in the late game. You also have to manage nutrition and have to eat a balanced diet. But that's annoying, so I played on peaceful mode most of the time. And just like how there are hundreds of ways to get the same material, there are hundreds of ways to make energy. Energy produced by putting dragon's breath in a machine. Energy produced by putting apples in a machine. And so on. The end game requires up to 3 million RF per dick, with RF being the main unit of energy in the mod. But how do you get this much energy? Two words. Nuclear reactors. There are a wide variety of reactors in the mod, ranging from the miniature sun that should not be used under any circumstances, this multi-block machine supported by a bunch of other machines, the reactor donut, and the steam-powered turbines, which can make hundreds of millions of energy per tick. Of course, you're going to have a lot of spare energy. So as usual, there's a bunch of options you can use to store it, which I'm not going to get into. The limitless possibilities and different options you have will be a common theme. There is no main storyline either, you are free to do as you wish. Which brings us back to the end goal. While everything in the game eventually leads up to this final item, which will basically grant you creative mode and survival mode, which is the main goal of this pack. There are so many other things that you can do. While I was thinking about how to approach creating this vid, I scrapped the idea of describing the entire playthrough in an orderly fashion. There was too much to go through. There were too many details to talk about. Too many things required explaining. The only way to know about the full experience is to experience the experience yourself. I am unable to describe the full thing in a single video. Due to this, I'm only going to describe the highlights of this playthrough, and leave out the stuff that was, relatively, not as interesting. So, at the suggestion of Ancient Old Man, I began the playthrough. Speaking of old men, 0.2% of my audience are elderly old women. If you are an elderly old woman, please explain why you are interested in watching these types of vids. I am not complaining though. If you are an elderly old woman or basically any age or any gender, please subscribe. Can we hit 200,000 subs? Okay, anyways, back to what we were talking about. In just 2 days, I gained the ability to fly in survival mode, after creating the Angel Ring, which is the earliest way to get permanent flight. After becoming fly-able, I relocated from my temporary wooden base to a platform high in the sky, where the mobs could not touch me. And in this base, were a few things worth mentioning. Due to all the hundreds of crafting recipes which I will definitely not be keeping track of, there is a way to automate crafting stuff. Which is this system over here. But not only can it craft stuff as in the things you would craft on a crafting table, it is capable of much more. Which brings us to the next important part of this playthrough. Machines. Whereas in vanilla the most complicated thing you'll probably do is craft stuff, this mod gets really deep and complicated. There are machines to react chemicals together. Machines to extrude ingots into other stuff. Machines that will automatically spawn the wither. There is a machine for mostly every purpose in the game. Machines to infuse two things into one thing. Machines that do that but with three. I could keep going on. but linking these machines to this aforementioned computer allows you to automatically make important stuff using the machines, without doing it manually. If the machines go too slow, you can simply upgrade them. These machines come from several different mods which use different types of upgrades. But the universal speed boost is the time in a bottle. The more you AFK, the more time is collected in your bottle. This time can then be used to speed up anything that uses tick rate, fast forwarding it by the amount of time used from your bottle. But of course, machines rely on power. And this aforementioned power comes from this. A melon generator. Which is linked to a machine that turns the melon into fuel for my real generator. This real generator powers everything in my floating base, and later on, the rocket that will be taking me into space. After building several advanced 3x3x3 machines and making some titanium, the first rocket was made. But why would we need to go to space? As for now, the rocket is only capable of going to the moon. On the moon you find these thingies. Next you launch a space station using the rocket. The space station can be anything you want. This idea will be explored later. In this space station, you build yet another 3x3x3 machine called the warp core, and fuel it with the thingies. This allows you to warp to any star in the Minecraft local bubble. We will be making a few stops around here and there around the solar system and other systems, because we will be mining these ores, which can only be found in outer space. And they were found. After returning with the dub, it was time to work on the next project. The nuclear reactor. Which will require many resources. But that was simple. I had thousands of ores from minions and running an automatic miner. But they could become more thousands. You feed the ores into an ore crusher, then you smelt the crushed ores into ingots. For a ratio of 2 ingots to 1 ore. With this, I now had thousands of blocks of ingots in storage. There's a way to quintuple ores, however. It involves a multitude of blah 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 that was simply unobtainable at the moment. Which was very sad. But anyways. After watching several tutorials and seeking help from Google, which will be a common theme in this vid, I had done it. A functioning nuclear reactor that would not shut down every 2 minutes, and would give me all the energy I needed for the rest of the game. So what did I do with this energy? Two words. Matter replicator. The mod developers recognized that some materials were simply too cruel to get. So they allowed you to replicate them with ease. But not so fast. Matter replication requires this purple liquid, which can only be made in this machine, which will gobble up millions of energy every second. So that was exactly what happened. Next. I set up a void miner. Which will mine void crystals. And that was all. Now it was time for better armor. I decided to go straight for wyvern armor, which has a force field that nullifies all damage and knockback, as long as you feed it energy. This aforementioned armor set requires nearly every late game armor set in the game combined, as well as one of the rarest resources in the game, draconium. But I pulled through. Most of the armor sets can be dropped from naturally spawning mobs. One of the most overpowered mob farms is the Cursed Earth Farm. By killing a wither skeleton, you obtain drops of evil. Right-clicking them on grass turns them into cursed grass. And this cursed grass spawns many, many entities. After putting conveyor belts on top of the grass, all leading towards certain death, and a vacuum to pick up the juicy armor, I was now rich. After combining all the armor sets and draconium and stuff, I now had the awesome armor. Then it was time for the next step of my awesome plan. I relocated everything inside a mountain. I basically shot myself in the foot by doing this, because mobs kept spawning everywhere in my base now. However, I had an awesome comeback. Okay, and in this mountain, was my sacrifice altar. But who do we sacrifice? The answer was simple. Villagers. Villagers are the most efficient life forms to sacrifice, so I put down a villager spawner that fed into the altar. Unfortunately, most villagers suffocate to death before I can sacrifice them. Which was really sad. But why do we need to sacrifice stuff? Is I go by lots of names just a deranged lunatic? sacrifice is necessary to obtain the ethereal slate, which will be used to craft this blue crystal. This aforementioned crystal requires a bunch of magical stuff from other mods. This stuff includes stuff that comes from altars high in the sky that only work at midnight. Brewing pots that can dissolve basically any item you put into it, to create special ingots. Potions made with blood obtained from sacrificing villagers. And portals to the elven world used to trade other special ingots. Put all of this together and you have the blue crystal. But that's not all. The blue crystal's counterpart is the yellow crystal. Made from the ores only obtainable in other space, a bunch of void crystals, and stuff obtained only from the most advanced tech stuff. But at this point, I basically had most of the machines I needed to proceed to endgame. Although I left out the process of getting them because there was more interesting stuff to talk about. But anyways. These yellow and blue crystals will be very important in endgame recipes. Speaking of endgame. I was about to begin the bragging rights quest line. After 2 long weeks. I created the crafting table with the 9x9 crafting grid. But not so fast. That's not the only crafting thing you will use. Whereas you have crafting tables ranging in sizes from 3x3 to 9x9, it also forces you to craft items using more overly dramatic methods. Some items like this require fusion. The infrastructure for this aforementioned fusion is quite expensive. You must put a fusion crafting core in the center, and up to 12 fusion injectors. Placing items in them and feeding them energy will often lead to fusion if the recipe is correct. You will be doing this a lot. Next up, are crafting recipes where a bunch of items are orbiting another item in a circle, aka combination. To make these, you need up to 20 pedestals surrounding one crafting core. You put the materials on them and they will magically combine. Eventually. Plus it needs energy. Finally. You have singularities, which will be very important later. Putting 10,000 of the same item in a quantum compressor will give you a singularity of that item. Plus it needs energy. After crafting some yellow and blue crystals using the combiney thingy, it was time to make the bragging rights items. There are 5 bragging rights items that we will be focusing on. All of them will require the yellow and blue crystals, and ultimate ingots as well, but we will get to that later. The first 2 give basically infinite energy. The next 2 give infinite liquids and gases. The 5th one is made from the first 4 items, along with many other things, and gives infinite items. Which means you basically beat the game. But first. The creative power cell and generator. Made from massive amounts of certain metals, wood, cobblestone and other materials and blah blah blah. To get the materials needed. It was time. To make the dimension builder. Which is made from this, with the aforementioned this, made from this. You will also need the dreaded, infinity catalyst. The infinity catalyst is made from singularities of a bunch of the main metals and alloys in the game, as well as stuff from every mod in the game, including these crystals. How would I get all this stuff, you may ask? It was simple. While the top half of the recipe was relatively easy, the bottom half is the real issue. Needing hundreds of thousands of ingots. But I have about 20 words. Void miner making many ores that are sent into this grinder and into this smeltery and into this storage. And then AFKing for some time while it did its thing. After several hours of doing other activities, I went to the mining room to find several quadribajillion trillion ingots. After feeding tens of thousands of them into the alloy smelter using an automatic system and eventually feeding them into the singularity compressor, I had all the singularities I could need. And it went straight into the catalyst along with all these other items that were not worth mentioning, and then this catalyst went straight into the dimension builder. Now we can make the not so fast. That's not the only infrastructure needed for dimension building. You need some teleportation stuff to actually get to the dimensions. And the dimension builder only builds a dimension. You need the dimension inscriber, which codes the dimensions using dimension parts. And the dimwit builder, which makes the dimension parts. The dimension parts are made from dimwits, which are dropped by endermen. So I killed what must have been 20,000 endermen using an automatic mob killer and an enderman spawner. Finally, I had quite a few dimlets. Now it's time to make the dimension. Let's say I wanted a dimension filled with huge balls of wood. You need a dimension part for huge balls, and a dimension part for wood. Putting them together gives you a dimension filled with huge balls of wood. So I did that. After building the dimension, traveling to the huge balls of wood dimension, and doing a little chopping, I had all the wood I would need. Now it was time for cobblestone, of which we would need hundreds of thousands of. To make this much cobblestone, there are these blocks that make hundreds of stone per second, which is way faster and more efficient than manually mining. Placing them next to storage will instantly fill the storage with cobble. So I put it next to a storage system, and waited, and waited. Now that I had a bunch of cobblestone, wood, and metal, it was time for the ultimate ingots. Ingots made from every ingot from every mod in the game, which will be used in most of the creative items. Most of the ingots were made from normal stuff I already had in my stockpile, but there were a few notable mentions. Ingots obtained from blasting gold with an AirPod shotty. Ingots obtained from finding a crimson cultist, imprisoning him in a soul capturer, using the soul to duplicate a bunch of cultists, killing them until you get the rare Crimson Rites book, studying it to unlock these things called void seeds, and then throwing the seeds into a pot with some ingredients, which will give you void metal. And ingots obtained by combining nether star nuggets and other ingots into a big ingot. The hardest two ingots, however, were Terra Steel and Insane Ingot. I will not explain the normal way of getting Terra Steel because it is boring and stupid. But now introducing Resource Seeds. If you could not make a dimension filled out of it, or use the Matter Replicator to make it, it was time to look to the Resource Seeds. There were a ton of different resource seeds growing different resources. And resource seeds can conveniently grow a bunch of resources that would be otherwise annoying to get. And it was possible to make Terra Steel seeds, which were ridiculously expensive and involved fighting a boss who calls himself Gaia, but it was obtained. Of course, you can't just plant them on the ground like measly carrots or other noob crops. You must put them in this machine, along with fertilizer and water. Kind of like a miniature farm, after quote-unquote, farming Terra Steel. I was now drowning in Terra Steel. Now it was time for Insane Ingot. Insane ingots are a type of ingot called the Essence Ingots, with Insane Ingots being the highest tier. They are made from mob essence, with the higher tier requiring 4 of the tier below it. The tier 1 essence drops from any hostile mob. But it was possible to skip right to Supreme Essence, which was right behind Insane. One wither drops 4 Supreme Essence. And you probably already know that using the stuff in this mod, you can farm withers. Which was exactly what happened. So after crafting 28 ultimate ingots, I now had everything including all these lesser items I will not be going through needed for the creative power cell and generator. The only other notable mention was Californium, of which you need 4 pieces. One piece was found in a dragon's den after slaying the original owner. The other 3 were made from reacting about 7 different fuels in some reactor, which took way too long. Now that was over with. It was time for the third creative item. The creative fluid cell. Made from mostly every fluid in the game, and the feared chaotic core. The only way of getting the chaotic core is to harvest the chaos crystals, located in the end dimension and guarded by the hardest boss in the game, aka the Chaos Guardian, which spawns 10,000 blocks away from the main end island. To beat this so-called Chaos Guardian, you must get the second most powerful armor set, sword, and bow in the game, called the Draconic Armor, Staff of Power, and Bow. Made from blah blah blah, okay whatever, I have it now. But it's not over yet. You must upgrade your gear considerably to stand a chance against the Guardian. And to upgrade your armor you need blah blah, okay I did it. With full upgrades. It is perhaps the most overpowered gear in the game. The bow becomes a machine gun. The sword becomes a nuker client, Killora client, and basically a bunch of things client all in one. And the armor makes you nearly invincible to anything. With this, it was now time to troll the Chaos Guardian. The Chaos Guardian is guarded by 2 rings of obsidian pillars, and it rapidly spits out several types of balls at you. Most of them are homing missiles. The red ones will suck all the energy out of your armor. When your armor runs out of energy, you die. The orange ones don't deal that much damage, but they come in massive quantity. I'm not sure what the other ones do, but I'm sure I won't be touching them. The dragon also flies at the speed of sound. It was going to be challenging, no doubt. But I would not refuse a 1v1 with a Chaos_Guardian. He lost, by the way. Now it was time to steal the Chaos Crystals. Mining the Chaos Crystals will cause a gigantic explosion in the island it is contained in, by the way. So I zipped out of there as fast as I could while watching the explosion. Now it was finally time for the Chaotic Core, which went straight into the Creative Fluid Tank. With this, we can now do a whole lot of trolling. Let me explain how it works. The Creative Fluid Tank is designed so that when you pour a fluid into it, the tank becomes filled with an infinite amount of that fluid. This can be reset by putting it into your crafting grid, by the way. But with an infinite amount of fluid, the Creative Tank kind of serves as an infinite item source and infinite gas source, to an extent. Here's how I cheesed the Creative Tank. There's this structure called the Smeltery, which will be seen throughout your entire average playthrough. It allows you to smelt materials into molten materials, which you can then cast into blocks or other items. But the thing is, molten materials count as a liquid. And you could use the Creative Fluid Tank to store an infinite amount of molten stuff. You can then connect the Creative Tank to the Smeltery using a pipe, which will cause the Smeltery to be filled with an infinite supply of the molten stuff. Using a redstone timer and some more pipes flowing into a casting basin, you can automatically create blocks from this infinite supply of molten material. These blocks can then be put into a chest with hoppers. And since there were many resources I needed that could be molten, it was time to do a little trolling. There was another resource called titanium that could only be found in outer space, and not from resource seeds, the Void Miner, or Dimension Builder. Or anywhere in particular. The only other way was to use this slow and expensive process, which was way too slow for what I needed next. However, titanium could be melted, and you know what that means. After simply getting a single titanium ingot, melting it, putting the molten titanium in the tank, and then using the smeltery to make an infinite amount of titanium blocks, I was now drowning in titanium. Now that was over with. The Creative Tank could also kind of make infinite gases. Allow me to show you how. There's a machine that evaporates liquids into gases. So by connecting the Creative Tank to this aforementioned machine, you probably know where this is going. But we won't really be needing water vapor. What we need is these really expensive gases for the Creative Gas Tank, which can be made easily with this infinite gas setup. And this is all legal, by the way. Out-of-the-box thinking in this mod is usually rewarding. But anyways, at this point, every resource could be mass-produced, with everything I have shown you up to this point. Everything I could ever need was at my fingertips. The next thing to go for was the Creative Gas Tank, which was pretty easy to get at this point. But the next item, the Creative Vending Machine, was on another level of hard. It required crafting recipes that were so advanced that they probably had hundreds upon hundreds of steps. And they did. Let me give you a quick rundown of what exactly is inside this vending machine. Some infinity ingots. Some tier 6 solar controllers. More crystals and ultimate ingots. The creative essence, which requires 108 insane essence. These computer thingies, and these dark blue boxes. To start off, it was time to make the most expensive ingot in the entire game. The Infinity Ingot. Made out of millions of ingots and hundreds of singularities. After making about 25 new dimensions, one for each of the materials I needed, and mining balls of blocks for what seemed like hours, and feeding it all to the compressor, and then using the Creative Fluid Tank strat to make thousands of other blocks needed for the ultimate singularity, which is made out of a singularity of every single ingot in the game, and doing a bajillion other steps, and then organizing them into ingot form. We can now do a whole lot of trolling. The first thing I did with this ingot was to melt it into molten infinity. You probably know where this is going. Straight into the Creative Fluid Tank and the smeltery. which meant we now had an infinite source of infinity blocks. Now that was done. The next thing was to make 2 tier 6 solar controllers, which requires a miniature sun. This is created by blasting a chaos shard with 7 of the highest tier fusion injectors. These injectors require a bunch of the dreaded chaos core. No problem, though. I was in the quintillion air grind set, after grinding out 7 of the cores and crafting them into injectors, and then placing them all over the place. The sphere was created. Now I could make the tier 6 solar controller. After that, all the other steps of the vending machine were a bit easier. It still took a while, but it was done. The next thing to do was to finish the rest of the bragging rights questline, which should be way easier now that I had to create a vending machine. I created the most powerful set of armor and weapons in the game. Then I proceeded to do whatever these are. After achieving the goal of the game, and basically becoming God itself in Minecraft, I only had one question left. What now? Then, I had a genius idea. I was going to make a vid about this modded experience. The quest line itself was pretty fun to go through. It was not linear. It took you through many adventures. And you still had a lot of freedom with what you wanted to do. And while achieving the final goals was quite challenging and at times tedious, it was very satisfying in the end. Of course, I left out about 80% of all the details. Because if I left them in, you would only be 20% done watching this. And I was not going to split this up into separate videos each covering about 100 days. I just gave you the more interesting experiences. I enjoyed the technology stuff more than the magic stuff, so I left out a lot of the magic stuff. Maybe it will be the other way around for you. Who knows? You have to play it for yourself to experience everything. It took me about 5 weeks to finish, so it's definitely something you could do throughout summer break. But anyways, shout out to the channel members and maybe sub for more OK stuff. Or watch this other OK stuff. Anyways, goodbye.